Hi friends, welcome to Relay Tutorials that is relevant, easy learning, accessible to you. This is probably the first video of year 2020 and I'm really sorry for all the delay caused. At the same time, we are going through a very tough phase. I request you all on behalf of our entire team to stay indoors, maintain social distancing, try to be positive and creative and let us utilize this time in learning new things. Coming to today's video, it is about case of acute abdomen, how to do history taking and examination. And let me tell you, it is one of the most commonly asked cases in your practical exams. So let us learn how to go about it. Acute abdominal pain accounts for 7 to 10% of all emergency department visits. It can range from life-threatening conditions like acute pancreatitis, peptic ulcer perforation, through some trivial causes like indigestion, constipation, etc. A good physician or surgeon would be one who reaches a provisional diagnosis and few differential diagnoses by thorough history taking and physical examination. So let's begin with that. And while taking history, it is very important to ask about the time of onset, whether it is acute, it has occurred suddenly, or it's chronic, that is, it's been there for quite some time, for a few days or so. Mode of onset is sudden, or there is a gradual increase, or there is a sudden increase. Duration, that is periodicity, whether it is periodic in nature, whether the intensity is varying with time, or is it a constant dull aching thing. Site of pain, the patient should be asked to point with his index finger the location of or the site of the pain, and if there is any shifting in the site of the pain. Radiation, in cases of referred pain. How's the character of pain? Whether it is colicky, constant burning, severe agonizing, throbbing, stabbing and dull ache. You have to actually quote examples or give them, you know, easy words by which they can describe whether it is that needle pricking thing, or is it a kind of wave which is coming and going back, or is it that dull discomfort which they have all the time? Whether there is a change in character of pain over a period of time. What are the aggravating and relieving factors? Like whether the pain changes or let's say decreases or increases on changing position from supine to prone, or you know, on sitting position. Does it have any sort of correlation with food intake? Is it associated with vomiting, or it gets relieved once a patient vomits? Why these things are important? Because pain related to ingestion of food can be gastric ulcer, pain relieved by food intake can be duodenal ulcer. Relief of pain by vomiting happens in cases of gastric outlet obstruction. Pain on recumbency and relief on erect posture can again happen in GERD. Pain on ingestion of fat can be a sign of malabsorption. Pain on defecation could be because of colonic causes, blood or mucus and feces because of colonic ulcers or carcinomas. Pain as food passed down to be digested and absorbed can happen in cases of intestinal angina. So, relation to normal physiological events is very important to have some idea about the etiology. When you take the history, do ask associated symptoms, that is nausea, vomiting, indigestion, loss of appetite or anorexia, and weight loss. Whether the bowel habits are regular or irregular, are there any associated urinary symptoms, gynecological symptoms. Menstrual history is again very important in women, especially in reproductive age. If there is any history of amenorrhea or missed periods, then you can even ask about the painful intercourse, use of intrauterine contraceptive devices, any episode of irregular vaginal bleeding or discharge per vaginum. When you come to past history, medical history of diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, stroke, any poisoning, intoxication, jaundice, tuberculosis, enteric fever, irritable bowel disease. In surgical history, if there is history of any chronic surgical illness, hospitalization, or in any invasive testing being done in the past. history of any blunt trauma or fall. Again, the occupational history is important if there is any history of exposure to carbon monoxide or lead. Drug history, if patient is on any chronic medication for acid peptic disease, any OTC, any herbal, Ayurvedic, homeopathy medicines he or she is on, any chronic history of analgesics or painkillers. When you come to family and personal history, family history, again, same history of chronic medical and surgical illnesses. And in personal history, any altered bowel and bladder habits, sleep pattern, change of appetite, any known addiction or allergy. I think this is the history which we have been talking about in our previous videos also. Now we'll move on to a very important part, that is examination. There are certain prerequisites which you need to fulfill. Wash your hands properly and dry them. Confirm patient's details once again. Introduce yourself. Be very empathetic towards your patient. I always say in my videos that if you want a good history out of your patients and if you really want them to cooperate, be very sympathetic and friendly towards them. Explain the need to examine also to the accompanying attendants. Explain the examination entirely. Gain consent, and once you have the consent, we can start with adequate exposure. Expose patient's chest and abdomen. And in case of a female patient, it goes without saying that you need a female attendant or a female nursing staff. Position the patient properly. Ask patient to breathe deeply and flex knees. Ask if patient currently has any pain and assess the severity before you actually begin. When you do a physical examination, I always follow this rule that you must just stand beside the patient cot for at least a minute or so. Just look carefully from head to toe. Look at any, treatment or adjuncts bedside, if that is feeding tubes, any stoma bags, drains, catheters, IV lines. Look at patient's generalized appearance. Whether he's in pain, he's tossing around, or he's lying a bit comfortably. Does he look confused or agitated? Or is he too drowsy to even answer your questions? How's the body habitus? Whether he's obese, low BMI, average build. Look at the dressings, any visible needle track marks, any signs of excoriations, and then start your examination. We always begin with vital signs, that is pulse, temperature, blood pressure, pallor, jaundice, and cyanosis. This we have discussed in our previous videos in detail. Look for any xanthelasma, that is raised yellow deposits surrounding the eyes, which are suggestive of hyperlipidemia. Any conjunctival pallor, which suggests significant anemia. Jaundice is noted in sclera, which can be due to hemolysis, hepatitis, any other liver disorders like cirrhosis, or if there is biliary obstruction. We always do head-to-toe examination. So after looking at the eyes, go for oral cavity examination. Look at the tongue, if it is dry-coated, if there is any smell, acetone smell. Look for any lymphadenopathy. Look at the angle of mouth, if there is any sign of stomatitis, which are inflamed red areas at the corners of mouth. Look for oral candidiasis, white slough on oral mucous membrane, which can be due to iron deficiency or in immunodeficient states. Any mouth ulcers, any glossitis over tongue, which is a smooth swelling of tongue with associated erythema, again can be there in iron, B12 or folate deficiency. Neck, look for all the lymph nodes, cervical lymph nodes. Any lymphadenopathy can be suggestive of infection or metastasis. Verkos nodes, that is left supraclavicular fossa, the enlargement can be suggestive of gastric malignancy. Look for any visible thyroid swelling. Ask your patient to deglutinate or swallow. You must know all the anatomical location or the anatomical position of various lymph nodes. Any examiner would ask you to do a bedside examination, and whenever you are doing it, press it very gently. Don't check by pressing too hard. Then coming to our main focus, that is abdominal examination. which by thumb rule we begin with inspection, a watchful inspection from epigastrium down till pubic region. Look at the contour of abdomen. There are a few situations for you to understand in a better manner. Contour is scaphoid or flat in cases of peptic ulcer, while it can be distended in ascites or any intestinal obstruction. See if there is any visible peristalsis, which you may find in a thin or malnourished patient if he comes with intestinal obstruction. Respiration would be sluggish in patients suffering with peritonitis or septicemia. Look for any visible mass. Try to assess the size and position. Pulsation. A central pulsatile mass may indicate an abdominal aortic aneurysm. Look for any discoloration over abdomen. Cullen sign, which is bruising around umbilicus, can be present due to retroperitoneal bleed in cases of pancreatitis or ruptured aortic aneurysm. Gray Turner sign, that is bruising in the flanks, and it is suggestive of retroperitoneal bleed. Abdominal distension, there are very interesting 7Fs. It can be due to fluid, that is ascites, or just generalized obesity, fat, feces in cases of constipation or obstruction, flatus, and interestingly fetus. Yes, in a female, one can come in lactational amenorrhea or with history of delayed cycles, who don't realize that they can be pregnant, and on examination, you actually diagnose their pregnancy for the first time. Any flipping great masses like uterine fibroids or massive splenomegaly. Food, celiac disease causes abdominal distension. Look for any visible stria. They can be reddish and pink, which are new in onset, or white silverish, which are old or chronic. They can be present in abdominal distension or previous pregnancy. Caput medusae, these are engorged paraumbilical veins, which you can see in portal hypertension. Look for any stomas, colostomy, ileostomy, or urostomy. Rule out any skin rash. Watch all the hernial sites carefully. Look for any previous scars, which is very, very important. Now we learn about a very interesting surface anatomy of abdomen. It is basically divided into 9 regions. There is a sort of a grid here, 2 vertical lines and 2 horizontal ones. If you look at the upper horizontal plane, also called as transpyloric plane, it corresponds to a line drawn joining the lowermost bony point of the ribcage, usually 10th costal cartilage, while the lower horizontal plane, also called as transtubercular plane, that corresponds to a line uniting the 2 tubercles of the iliac crest. The 2 vertical planes are similar on each side, and they follow a line joining the midclavicular point above to the mid-inguinal point below. And the above lines intersect and divide the abdomen into 9 regions. Clockwise from the top, epigastric region, left hypochondrium, left lumbar region, left iliac fossa, followed by suprapubic or hypogastric region, then right iliac fossa, right lumbar region, right hypochondrium, and in the center we have umbilical region. It is very important to learn these 9 regions, because whenever you are describing the site of pain or any abdominal mass, you have to give reference of these regions. There is another very interesting picture which I have put here. Here you can find some differential diagnosis based on the site or that particular region. Try to go through it and have an idea of differential diagnosis. Looking into the abdominal mass, it is important to differentiate the mass which is on the abdominal wall to that from the intra-abdominal one. The mass on the abdominal wall will become more prominent while tensing the abdominal wall vasculature, whereas an intra-abdominal mass will become less prominent or it might just disappear. Useful maneuvers are to have the patient hold his head unsupported off the examination table, or to hold his nose and blow, or to raise his feet off the table. Once the mass is determined to be intra-abdominal, its location should be described in relation to the abdominal quadrants which we just learned, which will help in determining the underlying cause. The mass should be examined for the movement with respiration or for pulsation with each heartbeat. Also, it should be observed for peristalsis as it may well represent a dilated wobble. I hope you find it interesting. Thank you for watching the video, and we will cover the rest of the examination part in the next video, which is soon following it. If you really like it, do share and subscribe. Thank you.